A package, for all intents and purposes, is what we call a container file. Or think about it the same way as a zip file. A container file is just a file that contains other files. So those might be binaries, it might be source code, it might be scripts. And then there's also a manifest that tells you what all this stuff actually means. And we use packages to deploy code dependencies to different projects or to install external tooling. It doesn't really matter what you use the package for. A package is just a collection of things that you need to use. And it also provides you a means to install them and update them in a meaningful way. So if you're a library or a tool creator, packages really help you with distribution. If I'm creating a tool that needs to go count the number of files in a directory, well, it's a simple tool. I could put it up on a web page and just tell people to go download it. Or I could create a package. I could put that package up in some sort of central repository or some central feed. And I can tell people, oh, go there and find it and download it. Know when things get updated, but it really helps with discovery. Because someone looking for use a file counting utility as an example, if they need to find a tool that meets that need, they're probably going to go type file counter or file counting utility, something like that. And if you have a package sitting out there that solves that need, you'll pop up in their search results and they can go download your tool. Now, there's a couple of different types of packages. I tend to talk about packages more from a software development standpoint, and that's just because I'm a software developer at heart. But that doesn't mean that software developers are the only ones that can really take advantage of packages. So there's fundamentally three types of packages: developer packages, application component packages, and then what we call machine packages. Developer packages are probably the most commonly used. It's what I see the most out there in the industry. But these are used by software developers to put out different types of dependencies. Doesn't matter if it's open source or if it's some component manufacturer. I'll use jQuery kind of as the across the board well-known example. If I was developing an application with jQuery, I could just go to jQuery, grab the JavaScript files and pull them into my application. But I could also install a package, which would then set up in my environment, not just the code for jQuery, but also the version of jQuery. And it could tell me when new versions of jQuery are available, or if it's a major update or a minor update. I do a lot in the .NET environments. We use a library called JSON.NET. It's one of the most popular packages in the .NET ecosystem. And we use that for JSON manipulation. So everyone goes and gets that package. We just know that's the thing that we have to go get. And all these different package managers have their own, or all these different packages have their own package managers to go with them. The .NET realm, it's Node.js has NPM and so on. And we'll talk about some of the others in a moment. We also have application and component packages. These are things that you might use internally that aren't necessarily available for public consumption. So I'm not going to go to a NuGet feed and pull down your internal packages, because that's not stuff you want to put out into the public. And this is where UPack, which we're going to talk about later, really fits in to the ecosystem, because you have stuff that doesn't fit into the mold of other packaging systems, but you still want to package them up and make them available to the rest of your team. So we'll talk about UPack and how UPack can help that. And finally, you have machine packages. These are tools and utilities that mostly system administrators might use. Developers use them as well. But if you've ever done anything with PowerShell, you probably have used Chocolaty. If you're a Linux-based administrator, you've used apt-get, you've used, forgot what the Red Hat tool is at the moment, RPM. So if you've used these package managers before, but they're installing utilities. I want a utility that tells me the IP address of my machine. Okay, that's just a package that you install. I want to search through all the files on my file system for a keyword. All right, that's a package that you install. Everything's a package. And these aren't just tools that you install and run at the command line. We need to think about packages in a little bit of a broader sense. Anyone out there that has a smart device, whether it's iOS or Android, you installed applications from an app store probably. Well, an app store app is just a package. You're installing a single file with a collection of binaries and different metadata inside of it. And then once it's installed, you can use it. But machine packages really solve a fundamental problem. How do we quickly and efficiently install software and utilities? And like I mentioned before, it's more than just the installation. It's about the maintenance and maybe the eventual removal of the package as well. If I install a Windows application, and that Windows application puts files in a directory, but then it goes and edits my registry, and then it puts stuff into a system folder. Well, what's going to track what damage that installer did? Or maybe damage isn't the right word. Maybe what changes did that installer make? Because that application is not self-contained, it's difficult to go back and clean up after it. Anyone who's done Windows administration, if you remove a complicated app, well, the files might be gone and some of the registry keys might be gone. But if you really want to go back and clean up the system, you have to go manually find registry keys that got created, remove those, go look for any external files that might have been created during the lifespan of the app, delete those. It's just a headache to do all this cleanup. If we think of applications in more of a package sense, deleting the package should technically do all the cleanup for us. I touched on this a little bit earlier, but Linux has been doing this forever. Debian uses apt-get, Red Hat, Yum, RPM. There's also package managers in Arch and Gentoo. If you're on Windows, you probably have used Chocobi. It's coming up as the most popular package manager on Windows for system admins, just because it makes it simple to do the things on Windows that Linux users have been doing for years and years and years. All right, so this is just more redundancy of what I've talked about before, but with machine packages, we can track the dependencies of a package. Imagine I'm installing a utility, and that utility depends on another utility. So here's an example. I'm installing an app, but it needs a third-party database driver. Well, I could package the database driver with my package and just serve everything up as a whole, but then I'm consolidating all the dependencies and all the updates. So what if there's a critical bug in that database driver that could be fixed independently of my application? Well, I could tell my app, my package, that it needs to depend on another package and it needs to have at least a certain version of it, if not a newer version. Well, those two packages can coexist on my machine. They can update independently of each other. I can enforce versioning. So I could say it needs to be at least 1.0, but it needs to be less than 2.0. And the package manager will manage all of that for us. And like I said, cleaning up and removing remnants of a package, that's really important. If we install it, we should be able to remove it and not know that it ever existed. All major platforms have package feeds or some sort of package.